And joining me now is Congressman Sean Casten of the 6th District, seeking another term of Congressman, a newly crafted district. So you're representing, would represent a lot of people you've represented before, but now you got some new folks in the southern part of the area. So what are you telling folks who don't know you as to why they should vote for you?
Well, number one, it's really fun. I mean, it's a weird thing. The redistricting is a fun process because when I first got into this line of work back in 2018, I had to introduce myself to all these new people, and you're learning how to do your job and understand what connects with people. And I've been telling everybody and going to the new district, most of what we vote on in Congress affects the entire country. But the voices that we hear are the voices of our constituents. And there's, I think, something really healthy about the redistricting process, that it's different types of communities, different people. You go out, you meet people.
Are you hearing any different concerns from the new areas that you hadn't heard before?
Yeah, they're different communities. I won't have Barrington anymore, and I will have Orland Park and Tinley Park, and you know, these are, you know, generally a bit more working class communities, a bit less sort of more the bedroom communities that I've got right now. So there's some differences there, but I think that in general, we have so much more that unites us as Americans than divides us. And when you realize the things that people care about are the same everywhere. You know, they want us to lower the cost of prescription drugs. They want us to give a better planet to our kids than the one we got from our parents. They want us to defend our democracy, and those are shared values.
Now, Congressman, I know you went into April with about $2 million in the bank. So just in a general way, how are you spending that money? Is it targeted TV ads? What are you doing?
We're doing what every campaign does that's got the resources to do it. We've been putting mail in people's mailboxes. We're doing digital ads. We'll be up on TV pretty soon, trying to make the good people at WGN as much money as we can.
Well, with that, thank you. So now, look, as you just said, when you know you deal with constituents, but issues are national as well. Yeah. So the Democrats did not get Build Back Better through. Prices are up at the pumps. Energy, which is critical for you. You love the concept of energy. But things aren't happening the way you had planned for them. So what message are you able to send people that they should bring Democrats back?
Well, look, number one, Build Back Better isn't over. I actually led a letter with 89 of my colleagues to center reconciliation processes on those climate provisions. And I think we have a path in the Senate now to go get that done. You know, I think the basic message that I'd give to people is to hearken back to, you know, as a famous politician from Dixon, Illinois once said, are you better or worse than you were 2 years ago? And if you think about where we were as a country 2 years ago, we had a president that denied COVID was real. We had the biggest collapse in our stock market in history, the biggest collapse in spike in unemployment, collapse in GDP. And we've now got an economy that's creating jobs faster than it's creating workers. We've got an economy that is, we're concerned about overheating, but you know that the only thing that is inflating faster than your cost of goods is wages. And so we've actually seen a surge. When you talk to people and say, how are you doing? There's real pain at the pump. There's real, you know, we got to do things to lower costs for families. But there's a reason why there's $2 trillion more in consumer savings right now than there was 2 years ago. And we've now got, not only did we avoid a second Great Depression, not only did we create all these jobs, but we're now re-onshoring manufacturing, which is creating pressure on more jobs. That's a great problem to have. And we now once again have the United States as the leader of the free world. When I was in Madrid for the first climate conference, I had a European parliamentarian who said to me, and this was after the United States had pulled out of the Paris Climate Accord, and I was one of 12 people selected to represent the United States, even though we had pulled out. It was a great honor. And this gentleman pulled me aside and he said, you know, we got some history out here that really bad things happen when the United States doesn't lead. And we now have the entire country, Republican and Democratic alike, supporting the idea that we need to protect our friends in Ukraine, that we need to make sure that NATO is strong, that we need to stand up to Putin. That is diametrically opposed to where the world was 2 years ago. And that's a direct result of policy choices that we've made over the last 2 years.
And these are issues we're certainly going to hear in a general election down the line, but you got to get through a primary first, so I want to put a little focus there. I'm interested to know how you are dealing with the dynamic of running against a colleague who was once an ally of yours.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, the redistricting process is messy, and I know a lot of us in the country are dealing with these sorts of things. You know, we'll go through. I'll be sorry to lose her voice in Congress, but it's the nature of our elections.
And part of the primary election process is, and I don't know a better way to put it, except you have to convince voters who were perhaps in her district and now would come to this new district, but you have to convince them to fire her and hire you.
Well, I'm the incumbent in this district, so I'm not sure I'd quite put it that way. But the
with lots of folks from her old district.
Well, sure. But I go back to what I said before, that I think there's so much more that unites us than divides us. I would not be in this line of work unless I was able to not only convince a lot of people who have a D after their name to vote for me, but to convince a lot of people who had historically voted Republican to vote for me as well. When I won in 18, I won by 7 points. My predecessor had won by 18 points in the prior cycle. J.B. Pritzker lost on the same ballot I won. And I think if you approach this job by recognizing what people have in common with each other and where our shared values are, and not compromise on your own values, lean in, but remind people of where those shared values are. If they vote for you, then you have this great privilege and this great responsibility. If, on the other hand, you go in and say, you should vote for me because part of my party is wrong and I represent the good part of my party and the other party is terrible, you're gonna have a hard time. You might be able to do that in a really, a really gerrymandered district. You can't do that in Illinois 6th.
People will be looking at character and all sorts of issues. So there are certainly ethical issues on both candidates, you and Congresswoman Newman right now. I want to give you a chance to respond to some of the stuff that we're reading about in February. It was reported and confirmed by the FEC that it had received a complaint about your campaign, which alleged that the campaign committee in 2018 illegally colluded with a super PAC funded by your dad in airing $130,000 worth of ads attacking your then primary rival. Response to that?
There's no story there. Look, anybody can file a complaint, and somebody associated with my opponent filed a complaint. I can, I could send a letter to the police that says that you hate dogs. Wouldn't make it true, but it's a piece of paper. It was properly filed. There's no truth to any of those stories. These were raised sadly by, one of the things that happens in this line of work is that when you get in trouble, you can either acknowledge the trouble that you're in, or you can try to manufacture a crisis to suggest that all sides are equal. My opponent's in a real ethics issue. She's being investigated on a bipartisan basis by the ethics committee because she really did violate the law. That's a problem, and I hope she's innocent. I've asked her to disclose the terms of the settlement. She's paying $24,000 a quarter to a gentleman who she had previously signed a contract and said, if you don't run against me in the primary, I will hire you on my staff. That's illegal. She's being investigated. That's a real issue. The allegations that have been made against me are not real issues. They're issues that are designed to muddy the waters.
And I'll still have a chance to talk about that with me as well. So let me go to something that perhaps is tied to the campaign itself and related to the new district, because some folks who are pro-Marie Newman have said your campaign committed what they're calling fraudulent behavior in sending out a mailer to people in the southwest suburbs in the 19th ward of Chicago, specifically people who are in what would be her ward. Her area right now, her district right now, currently in the third. And the mailer said that you, Sean Casten, are proud to be their new U.S. rep. But in reality, you wouldn't be their rep yet. So response to that challenge.
Yeah, no one was confused by that mailer. It's trying to manufacture a controversy. No one called our office confused that we needed to help them out on some constituent services issues. We were introducing ourselves to new voters. This is the 6th district. I currently represent the 6th district. We were letting folks know that the new 6th district has some different boundaries. There's going to be a new election. I'm proud of what we did. And there's nothing there but an attempt to manufacture a controversy.
Where does that stand in terms of a complaint? Do you know?
There is no complaint. It was a manufactured controversy to try to get media attention.
If you make it through the primary in November, you'd also be running against on the Republican side. Obviously, the possibility, there are several, but there are two well-known suburban mayors who are running on that end. And so I'm just curious how you would approach the Democrats' handling of COVID, of the economy, when it comes into the race where you'll have some potentially well-known Republicans.
Well, it's this is still a very purple district. It still is a district where you
turned it initially.
When I flipped this district from red to blue in 2018, it was the first time that a Republican had held this seat, or that a Democrat had held this seat since 1972. And, as I said, we resonated with people because we talked to them about our shared values. I joke sometimes at my town halls that I say I'm going to get partisan, and I'm not supposed to get partisan in a town hall. But I think the good guys won the Civil War, the good guys won World War II, and the Enlightenment was a step forward in human progress. And it always gets a laugh, but I mention that in the context of COVID because we had we had not Republican voters, but elected Republicans saying that COVID was a hoax, saying that you were better off taking horse medicine, saying that, that masks didn't protect people. This is not an area where you should be bipartisan. This is an area where we have a responsibility to make sure that we save people's lives. And I think, I don't care whether you're a mayor or you're the president of the United States, either you're honest with people or you're not. And I think folks respect people in this line of work who are honest with them.
Let me take you into a world you're comfortable with, which is the electric vehicle world, the Electric Vehicle Grid Readiness Improvement and Development Act. So you introduced, as a member of the House Select Committee on Climate Crisis, co-chair of the House Sustainable Energy and Environment Coalition Power Sector Task Force, long title. But here's the thing. So the bill is designed to make electricity demand of electric vehicles the infrastructure, move it at a swift pace, getting it along. But one of the things you hear often from Republicans from the other side is, we can't afford electric vehicles, so you're making it easier to charge them up, but we can't afford them in the first place.
Well, the first to just make a general observation about automotive markets, every advance in vehicle technology has always started in high-end vehicles, right? You know, from tape decks to GPS to heated seats, they started in the high-end vehicles and they worked their way down. That's just the way that vehicles come to market. We're now in a world where those early electric vehicles are now hitting cost parity, and we're seeing surges. Last month, U.S. car sales declined by 1.6%. Electric vehicle sales were up by 70%. We're seeing the markets that want this technology because the vehicle's a little bit more expensive, but then you don't have to pay for gas anymore. People really like that. You have great acceleration. People really like that. We've got some incentives. Illinois has some terrific incentives. We've got some more that we're trying to pass through to get people over that little hump and really make sure that we address the equity issues, because right now this is being adopted first by wealthier folks and we need to get around. The bill that you mentioned that we've done is a really, really important piece that if we just do what markets are telling us they want to do, they want to build electric vehicles, people want to buy electric vehicles. If we meaningfully start electrifying the fleet as we already are, we're going to exhaust the capacity of our electric grid to provide that charge just because of the amount of energy that we need. And so this bill that Congressman Tonko and I introduced is to have the DOE really do a robust analysis of our electric system and figure out where we need to bolster, where are people going to be charging, how do we make sure that the resources are there so that people like ComEd or Ameren can then go through and say, okay, we need to bolster up this part of the system so that people who have this technology they want can get it in. And we did that when we electrified rural America in the 30s. We did that when we built out a gasoline vehicle charging station. And we have this fantastic opportunity right now to give people what they want and make sure the infrastructure is there so that that as they buy it, they can make sure that they can fuel their vehicle.
I want to ask you a climate question as well, another related climate question, because that's so important to you. And Bloomberg recently reported that Biden's climate ambitions are, their words, all but dead, based on all this going on and whatever. So this is important to you. And if Republicans take control of Congress in the next 2 years, what's going to get done in the world of climate?
Well, when we were starting to work on what became the Build Back Better, the speaker invited myself and a couple other the climate leaders into her office to say, okay, what are the boundaries of what we need? Excuse me. And I said to her at the time, what I need is to be able to look my kids in the eye and say that I did what was necessary. And if you ask me for details, I'm going to sound politically naive. We have to decarbonize so much faster than even the greenest voices in our society sometimes are quite aware of. And that feels really politically hard, because it is really politically hard. And if we say that the best thing for us to do this moment is to kick the can down the road and maybe hope that in the future this will be politically easier, we don't deserve the jobs we have. People elect us to lead. And so we've been, that's a part of why I've been so outspoken, number one, about making sure that in this reconciliation package we prioritize those climate provisions, and I think there's a way that we can get that done. But also to really make sure that people understand that our transition to a clean economy is a transition to a cheap economy. The single best thing we could do for inflation is put people in a position where they don't have to buy gasoline, where they don't have to buy natural gas, where they don't have to buy oil, because you can run on things that don't cost anything, like solar and wind and geothermal and even nuclear has very low marginal operating costs. The reason we haven't done what makes economic sense already is because we have so heavily subsidized our fossil sector. The United States subsidizes the fossil fuel industry by $650 billion a year. That's as much as we spend on Medicaid. It's almost as much as we spend on defense. And the more we can get people to understand that and lean in and own it, I tell my Republican colleagues, like, you know, I agree we shouldn't pick winners and losers. Why do you all keep picking losers? You've got an industry that has been unable to compete without getting these massive subsidies. Just imagine how much entrepreneurial vigor we could unleash if we took those subsidies away.
Real quickly, loan forgiveness, because it's a big, it's a topic and discussion right now. And the, you know, Republicans people look and say, look, why should we pay off your loans? You went to school, you know, you get a job, pay off your loans. Why should I pay off your loans?
So there's a really interesting question about, number one, I don't think that, maybe I spent too much time as a CEO. I don't think it's in our interest as a country for us to maximize the equity on the federal balance sheet, right? If we did a public-private partnership, no one would say that the government should own all the asset. Like, we want, you know, we want the private sector to own that and we want to grow that. In the same way, if we are providing a loan that's an asset to the federal government, we're loaning money to an American who now has a debt, they have a liability that they owe us back, we haven't created any net wealth. Right, we have one American who owes money. We have one American who is due the end of that money. And the question on student loans becomes: what happens if that debt can't be repaid? Because if I was in a private business and I said there's a significant chunk of the $1.7 trillion in assets that are held by the federal government in debt that's due, we know Jay Powell has told me, the chairman of the Federal Reserve, he's told us on the Financial Services Committee, that a significant portion of that asset that the federal government holds should not be counted as a real asset because people don't have the ability to repay it. What value are we providing by holding that there, right? All we're doing is hurting somebody's credit score. We have a fiction that this is, you know, bolstering our long-term well-being as a country. And yet the chairman of the Federal Reserve himself says that a lot of folks just can't afford to repay those loans. So I think it's a question, if we were in a private business, we would say, well, you have to write down that asset because it's not collectible, right? In the government, we can't do that, but I think we do have to have a conversation that says, this isn't everybody, but for those folks who are sitting there saying, I just can't afford to repay this, I'm gonna die with this debt still sitting out there, what do we gain as a society by holding on to that? Or wouldn't we be better off into giving that person the ability to free up and make other choices that maybe they can start a business, maybe they can invest, maybe they can buy a home, all these things that they could do but for that amount? So I think there's a more sophisticated accounting conversation we can have that's just a categoric absolute, keep 100% of this liability, get rid of 100%. I think there's a reality in the middle of, let's make sure that the people who can't afford to repay aren't just creating a fiction on their balance sheet and ours.
Final question, quick answer. Number one priority for a new district if you represent it?
You know, the answer will depend on what the voters in the area want, but I think that I still am driven every day by trying to make sure that I can look my daughters in the eye and say that at the end of the day I left them a better planet than the one I inherited from my parents. That's our obligation. This job is a relay race. It's not a sprint. We get the baton from whoever held the office before us, and we try to pass it along and make sure that we preserve our democracy in the process and preserve our planet in the process. And I think as long as we do that and we do right by everybody, then we're doing this job in the right way.
Congressman Sean Casten, thank you for your time.
Thank you so much.
Appreciate it.
Always a pleasure.